Hello students, it's Dr. Sansom here for your pre-lab lecture for experiment 9, which is to determine the Ksp of calcium hydroxide. In lab today, you're going to be working on the process skill of oral communication. Because you'll be talking about complex ideas related to equilibrium and solubility, we want you to pay attention to the language you use, using relevant and effective language, and also the way that you're interacting with your lab partner by listening, showing attention by nodding and making eye contact, and also promoting exchange of information, like checking for understanding among your group members. So the first question is, what is Ksp? Ksp is the solubility product constant, and it represents the equilibrium constant for dissolving and dissociating of a mostly insoluble ionic compound. So if I have an ionic compound, Mx, this would be the chemical equation that goes with the Ksp, where my Mx dissolves and dissociates into M plus ions and X minus ions that are aqueous. Typical values for these will range from 10 to the minus 5 to 10 to the minus 20. And so that means the reactants are favored and it tends to not dissolve. It tends to stay solid. In this lab, you'll be calculating the Ksp for calcium hydroxide, but I'm going to show you an example of how you would do this if you were calculating the Ksp for lead to iodide, PbI2. And this is when you know the equilibrium concentration of lead ions and of iodide ions. In your experiment, you're going to measure the concentration of hydroxide ions by doing a titration with acid. When you neutralize the hydroxide ions, you'll know exactly how many there are, and that'll be twice as many as the calcium ions. Okay, so in this situation, we have lead ions and iodide ions. And notice, because the formula is PbI2, when it dissolves into solution, it's going to make twice as many iodide ions as lead ions. And we see that reflected here. So if I write the chemical equation for this reaction, I've got PbI2 solid, and it's in equilibrium with the aqueous lead 2 plus ions and 2 I minus ions. And my expression for the Ksp is just the concentration of lead ions times the concentration of iodide ions squared. Because the PbI2 is solid, it doesn't show up in our Ksp expression. So I can substitute the values in and calculate our Ksp value, 1.39 times 10 to the minus 8. One of the steps along the way in this experiment is finding the molar solubility of the salt that you're studying. And this is the number of moles of a substance that dissolves in 1 liter of water at 25 degrees Celsius. This can be affected by the type of solvent. We're going to use water, but there are other types of solvents, and you can imagine that ionic compounds wouldn't be as soluble, for example, in something like hexane that's nonpolar. We are going to talk about temperature and also the presence of common ions and how those affect the molar solubility. In your experiment, the value of the molar solubility is the same as the concentration of calcium ions, because for every mole of calcium hydroxide, you get 1 mole of calcium ions. Now, how does temperature affect solubility? This is a chart that shows how many grams of solute can dissolve in 100 grams of water, and it shows the temperature dependence. And you may notice many of these lines go up as we increase the temperature. Those are all salts. And some of the lines go down as we increase the temperature, and those are gases. So why does this happen? Most salts become more soluble at higher temperatures. And the reason is because there's a positive change in entropy when they dissolve and dissociate into the solution. But the opposite is true for gases, because when gases dissolve, they're more constrained in the solution than they were when they were free gases on their own. Another thing that can impact molar solubility is the common ion effect. And a statement of the common ion effect is that a weak electrolyte is less ionized if an ion that would result from its ionization is present. So for example, if I have some compound and it can dissociate into ions, but then I add some extra, maybe some of the C plus or the D minus here. In your experiment, the hypothetical situation we're talking about is adding additional calcium ions to your solution. And essentially, if we were to add the calcium ions here, it would shift the equilibrium to the left and we would end up with more solid. So if we're starting out with a saturated solution, which means we have no solid, everything is just as dissolved as it can be. But then we add an excess ion, we expect that it's going to then shift back towards the reactants and it will actually cause a precipitate to form. And in our case, that would be the calcium hydroxide. When we add a common ion, it will decrease the molar solubility. So the amount of CD that's able to dissolve will actually be smaller. So why are we doing this with a titration? Because we're talking about solubility, but it turns out the substance that we're looking at is calcium hydroxide. The lime water that you're going to be using is a saturated solution, which means as much calcium hydroxide that can dissolve is dissolved in that solution. So in fact, if we can measure the concentration of the hydroxide ions by reacting it with acid, and of course taking advantage of the fact that when we get to the end point of our titration, we'll have equal numbers of moles of H plus ions and OH minus ions, equivalent numbers of moles of acid and base according to the chemical equation and the stoichiometry in the chemical equation. When we do that, we can infer the concentration of the calcium ions. So we can measure the hydroxide directly, but we know that the calcium will be 1/2 as much as the hydroxide because there's one calcium ion for every 2 hydroxide ions. When we know the concentration of calcium ions, we'll also know the molar solubility. And if we know both calcium and hydroxide, we can calculate the Ksp like I showed you earlier. There are a few safety things you should be aware of. Of course, you want to use goggles, gloves, your lab apron, and wear long pants and closed shoes. The chemicals that we're working with, hydrochloric acid and calcium hydroxide, are both corrosive. So you should be especially careful and make sure that you're wearing your goggles the whole time that you're using them. And calcium chloride can be harmful if swallowed. So that's the end of our pre-lab lecture for today. Thanks for listening. I hope you enjoy the lab.